Holy are you, Lord God, Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy.
Sing it out. You are holy.
Jesus, to your name. Praise you for this anointing, Father. His presence is here. Can I have two ushers? Follow me. Sing it out. Holy, 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 holy. Come forward, come forward. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Oh, we cry. There it is, there it is. Holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Before we even preach, if you feel God's doing something now, you're being touched now, you feel the anointing on you now, I want you to quickly push out forward. Quickly push out. You feel He's touching you now. Come out, quickly. The rest of us sing day and night. I want you to come out, quickly. Day and night. Night and day. Come stand here, come. God is touching you now, He's on you, He's busy. His presence is here. Yeah, yeah. Day and night, night and day. Woo. Day and night, night and day. Day and night. Oh, that is. Yeah.
You're worthy. Yeah.
Father, we love your presence. We're grateful that we can be here, that we can come as we are. We honor you. We honor your privilege. What a privilege to be here, Lord. Thank you that we can taste and see. Taste and see. For the joy that was set before you, you endured that cross. On the way to the cross, when you were dripping blood, you've endured. Because you've endured, we can stand here. Because you've endured, we can be in your presence. We thank you that you made a way. We thank you that you are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and you are the end. We are grateful. We're thankful. We're thankful, Father. With grateful hearts, we come into your presence. Thank you that boldly we can just be because of your blood. You've made a way that we can come into the house and we can abide. We can dwell here. We can stay here. We are part of your kingdom, Lord. We want to thank you. We want to thank you, Father. We want to thank you. Were you the usher? You were the usher. Raise your hands. From his head to his toes, I release the fire of God. Touch right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. We cry holy. We love your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's just hang here for 10 more seconds. Sing this one. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You're welcome to take your seat or do whatever you want to do. We're going to jump into it. His presence is here. We love your presence. We honor your presence. This is an open service. You do whatever you want to do, but just stay in the river. Come on, it's time to swim. Hey, some of you not swimming. The river is flowing through this church this morning. Come on. Some of you need to get wet this morning. Hallelujah. So I'm going to swim as I preach, if that is okay with you. I might go left, I might go right, I might go anywhere. Let's just flow. Is that all right? Can I preach this morning? Can I preach like an evangelist this morning? Sometimes we shout a little bit. My wife always says, Werner, don't shout at the people and don't preach too long. So I hope she has grace on me this morning so I can shout a little bit. Hallelujah. Can we just give the worship team a mighty shout in this place? Oh, we honor you guys. Thank you. You can stay with me a little bit if you want to. I would love that. Because we might just go back into it. Hallelujah. Hey, what a privilege for me to be here. I'm very excited to be here. Who was here last night? Hey, last night was amazing. But we go from glory to glory. Hey, we celebrate those healings last night. I couldn't sleep last night. My spirit was just singing, this is the air I breathe. Your Holy Presence living in me. Hallelujah. So before I just jump in, I want to say it's an absolute honor and a privilege to be here. I grew up in Klaagsdorp. So my life have changed on that carpet over there. That's the one stain they cannot get out. So I was crying there for many hours. My dad has been impacted by this ministry. Because of my dad's encounter, I'm standing here today. And it all happened in this building. So I want to honor God for that. And I do not take it lightly for one moment to be able to preach the Word of God in this place. So many memories. But what I can say is the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. Do you believe that? If you believe that, can I hear the loudest amen? Hallelujah. So first of all, I just want to honor Pastor Petrus. He's a dear friend. And his wife, happy birthday for yesterday again. I want to honor you and thank you for this privilege for having me. I really appreciate it so much. And Pastor Annelies, love you and honor you. Thank you for the price that has been paid and the price that you are paying for us to just come into a building like this and enjoy it. And it's so easy. It's so easy. A price has been paid. And what I can say is this is not a platform. This is an altar. And when you are on an altar, there was blood that was shed. And there was blood shed here. And that's why I don't take it for granted, because there was not my blood. Someone paid a price. And for that reason, I really want to honor you. Honor you for the price you're paying. And I know the best is yet to come. I feel an excitement in the spirit, in the atmosphere. I know this is a new season. This is a season where everything is going to look different. Everything's going to look different. This river is going to flow. Hallelujah. It's amazing to see. There's one thing I hear in my spirit. I've said it before, but I hear it now. But revival looks like something. Revival looks like family. And God is putting a family together because He's a family God. And the enemy is after family. You know what? That's not part of the message, but the enemy is an orphan. He will never have a privilege again. He has an orphan and he produces orphans. But me and you, we are sons and daughters. Therefore, we have a name. Why do we have a name? Because there is an inheritance. And when you have a name, you can access your inheritance. And by the way, we serve a name. And at the mention of that name, every knee shall bow. Every tongue shall confess that Jesus is the King, that Jesus is the Lord. And what this place and this church has been purposed for, we're going to walk in it in Jesus' name. We're going to see it not just in Stilfontein, in Clarksdorp. We're going to see that God is raising up revival families that will not just speak about revival, but will carry the fire, will carry revival, will become revival. We're not just waiting for a move, we're becoming the move of God. We're not just waiting for a fire to mysteriously come in. No, we carry that fire. Hallelujah. And we're going to take that fire out. We are not called to be firefighters. We are called to be fire lighters. So we're lighting fires. Are you with me? Fire lighters sitting in this building. Are we ready to make fire? Now, I do warn you a little bit. It's very dangerous to invite me because you don't know what's going to come out of my mouth. I also don't know what's going to come out of my mouth. Hallelujah. But what I can say is I'm a professional lover of Jesus. I specialize in loving the Son. I love Jesus. And I just want to honor, why do I even cry? Honor my wife for being with me and my two beautiful kids. We were in 18 days, 127 hours of services. And we had one day off, and now last night and today. So we love church, we love Jesus, but we want to be moved by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. So I don't know where we're going to go, but we're going to go anywhere. Let me just say one thing, because I always speak about this. One day, I went on a trip to Malawi. Can I come down a little bit? I went to Malawi for 2 weeks preaching the gospel, and I came home, and my wife, I haven't seen her in 2 weeks, so I really missed her. And I came home, and we sat on the couch, and I asked my wife a question. I said, "Hey wife, are you in love with me? I mean, I missed her. I was 2 weeks away." And her response was, she said, "Yes, yes, I love you." I said, "I asked you, are you in love with me?" She says, "Yes, I like you." So I looked at my wife, and my wife knows that I don't like feet. I don't like feet at all, but I said, "Give me your feet." I don't like looking at feet. I don't like smelling feet. I don't like anything about feet. In that moment, I said, "Give me your feet." So I started to work the feet. Busy with my wife's feet. You know? I said, "Where's that Dove cream?" So I'm busy with the feet. Working the feet. That morning, I come out of my prayer closet, and my wife comes out of the room. She says, "Today I feel so in love." That moment, the Lord spoke to me. He said, "Werner, when you encounter me," many people have an encounter. I love encounters. Encounters have changed my life. Me and my wife, we are in the ministry because of encounters. But when we encounter Him, our containers are being stretched. Our cup will overflow with oil. Our containers are being stretched. When you encounter Him, He's stretching your capacity so that you can carry more. But He said to me, "But the oil does not come from the encounter. The oil comes when you sit at my feet. The oil comes when it's you and me. The oil comes when no one is watching. The oil comes when you pick up that cross daily and you choose to follow Him. Doesn't matter what you see, what you feel, what you experience, what you're going through. That's where the oil comes from." So when we encounter Him like this, you better know tomorrow morning, that encounter, you take it home. And His purpose for an encounter is to become an encounter. Have an encounter, become the encounter, so that you can release. Because freely you've received, now freely you have to give. You can only give what you've encountered. You can only give what you've encountered, but you can also only keep what you give away. If you encounter joy and you don't give it away, eventually you're going to lose it. You have to give it away. That's the principle of the kingdom. Hallelujah. Now let me say this quickly. I don't know why my nose is crying this morning, but it happens now and then. We are mainly called for four things. If I read as an evangelist, number one is to be with Jesus. Number two is to become like Jesus. Number three is to represent Him. And number four is to advance His kingdom. Occupy until He comes. Hallelujah. Now the Bible says in John 20 verse 21, Jesus came to His disciples and then He said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. As the Father sent me, so I'm sending you. And then He went, receive the Holy Spirit. In that moment, three things happened. Number one, the mission of Jesus becomes our mission. That moment you receive the Holy Spirit, the mission of Jesus becomes your mission. Jesus is still doing on this earth what He did when He was walking here. Now He's doing it through me and you. Who's the Holy Spirit? It's Jesus without a body on this earth. Why doesn't He have a body? Because He wants to live in yours. Number two, the Bible says the Son of God has come to fight, to destroy the works of the enemy. Now it's our privilege to enforce what He has done already. The kingdom does not work automatically. The violent take it by force. There's a fight that we have to fight. We have to enforce what He has done already. And number three, He gives us the keys to the kingdom. Who's got the keys? Who has to use the keys? He's given it to us. Hallelujah. Are you with me this morning? Now, I think I want to speak about something here. And that might be about the fire of God. I love the heat. I love the fire. Do you love the heat? I'd rather burn with the fire of God than the fire of judgment. Whew. The fire of the Holy Spirit. But let me say you something. The Bible says, when you sit at His table, in the presence of who? Your enemies. He anoints your head. I read that. I said, Lord, that's amazing. I can sit here. I can look at You and my enemies watch how I gaze upon Your beauty. And I heard the Lord speak to me, said, that's not really what's happening there. I felt the Holy Spirit speak to me and say, Werner, what's happening there is because I anoint your head, your enemies becomes more. Because you are anointed, your enemies comes more. Therefore, you have to sit and look into my eyes so that you can stay focused. So you need to know when He anoints you, when you receive the Spirit of God, when the fire of God comes upon you, you need to know there's certain things you're going to face in life. And I want to show you from the story of Acts chapter number 28. This is the story of Paul. Soon I'm going to start preaching like evangelist. Is that okay? Can I shout a little bit? I was shouting the other day, preaching, let's call it preaching in Holland. And I'm busy doing my thing and I'm started to shout and I get so excited because I feel the power of God. And all of a sudden after the service, this lady comes to me. She said, can you please calm down? I said, excuse me? Why must I calm down? She said, Jesus didn't speak that way. Jesus didn't shout that way. I said, ma'am, I never said I'm Jesus. I said, second of all, if you look at the temple, what happened in the temple when they were trading in the temple, do you think He just went and said, hey, we're going to flip over the tables here. Can you just move aside? Hey, come on. Let me say this while we're busy. This is not about a one-man show. This is about the saints becoming the show. This is about the saints showing off in mighty signs, wonders, and miracles. Welcome to the sick healing generation. Welcome to the demon outcasting generation. The dead raising generation. Hallelujah. It's not about a superstar. It's about having an encounter with the bright morning star. His name is Jesus. Now I need you to speak back at me this morning. I need you to preach back at me. When I go out there and they're not saved, it's not always easy, but you are saved. So come on, I need to hear. Preach it, white skinny man. Hallelujah. So in the book of Acts chapter number 28, I want to show you three things you're going to face. Because God has anointed you for a purpose. Say purpose. No, like, looks like I have to preach this side because they're responding. Say purpose. Hallelujah. There's a fight we have to fight. It doesn't just work automatic. God's going to bless me. Now you sit on the couch. There's a fight to fight. We have to work this. Hallelujah. So in the book of Acts chapter number 28, this is Paul, and I love Paul. After having an encounter, being knocked off a horse, this is like 27, 28 years later. The man had such a deep encounter with Jesus that in Acts chapter number 26, when King Agrippa came to him, said to him, Paul, what's happening? He said, you've been shipwrecked, you've been beaten. Why are you doing what you are doing? This Paul, 25, 26 years later, after having that encounter, remember when he had the encounter, he recognized and said, Lord, what must I do? When that light was shining on him, he was not there by himself, but he's the only one that stood up and connected to that encounter. He's the only one that connected to the source. And then the Lord said, go to the city, and as you go, I'm going to reveal more to you. In other words, you're going to have more encounters. But now 25, 26 years later, he speaks to King Agrippa. He said, King Agrippa, you can't believe what happened. I had an encounter. I was blinded, but now I can see. With passion. He never lost the fire. He still had the fire. He picked up his cross every day. Now, I want to show you what happens when that fire comes upon your life. Out of the book of Acts, this is starting from verse number 1. Once we were safe on the shore, we learned that we were on the island called Malta. So Paul was busy going somewhere else, and all of a sudden there's a storm, and now they shipwrecked on the island called Malta. The people of the island were very kind to us. It was cold, number one, and it was rainy. Almost like this morning. It was very cold in Klerksdorp, in Stilfontein this morning. So they built a fire on the shore and welcomed us. This is the first test that you're going to face. When God anoints you, when God, you receive the Holy Spirit, He starts using your life. The first test you're going to face is the test of the flesh. It was cold and it was rainy. Yeah, but it's a little cold. Let's go to church next Sunday. Yeah, maybe this morning I'm going to sleep in because it's raining. The test of the flesh. The first test that you're going to face. But what did Paul do? As Paul gathered an armful of sticks and was laying it on the fire, Paul didn't go, oh my goodness, I'm going to sit here in a corner and feel sorry for myself. He went to get some sticks. He went to get some wood. The Bible says in Proverbs, there cannot be a fire without wood on the fire. You have to bring a sacrifice. So when He anoints your life, you got to speak to that flesh and you have to keep that fire going. When you have this encounter now, tomorrow morning, that encounter has to be kept. That passion has to be kept. You got to stir that thing up. You got to work that thing. Doesn't matter what comes your way. You got to put wood on that fire. It's the first thing he did. What happened then? A poisonous snake, driven out by the heat, bit him on his hand. The second test you're going to face is the test of the demonic. What did he do? He was bit by that snake. The Bible says this. The people of the island saw it hanging from his hand and said to each other, a murderer, no doubt. Though he escaped the sea, justice will not permit him to live. They believed when something bad happens to someone that they are a bad person. Now the snake bit him. But what did Paul do? But Paul, I love this part. But Paul shook off the snake into the fire and he was unharmed. He shook it off into the fire. Many people, when you start going, you overcome the flesh. All of a sudden you feel a type of resistance. The demonic is against you. The enemy is against you. He doesn't like what you're doing. You're overcoming your flesh. But if you don't have a fire going, you cannot shake it off. And I hear too many people say, oh, I can feel the attack.
I'm always under attack. I bind this and I come against this. I'm not against people doing that, but just hear what I'm saying. Many times the spiritual world's not even recognizing your voice, you binding and loosing and shaking. It's because there's no fire, so you cannot shake it off. But when you have a fire and you feel something, you shake it off. Say, okay, I feel you, but I recognize you, but you're not supposed to be here, so it's time for you to go. Shook it off. That's the second test you're gonna face. The people waited for him to swell up and suddenly drop dead. Now I feel the anointing of God. They waited for him to swell up and suddenly drop dead. The third test you're going to face is the people around you. It might be family sometimes. They say, but this is just a season. They waited for him to swell up and die. No, this is just a season. He's not really on fire. No, those miracles are not real. Hey, sir, it's a 100-meter sprint. It's not a 100-meter sprint, it's a race. How many people have told me in my life, yeah, you must just relax, slow down a bit. Sorry, ma'am, I hear you say I must slow down. I had this lady come knocking on my door. I grew up with this lady. She said, I want to come see you. We sat in the room. She said, Werner, aren't you taking this Holy Spirit thing too far? She grew up with me. I said, can I ask you a question? But it might be more than one question. Where were you when I was dancing on the tables? Where were you when I was drunk out of my mind? When I was lost and broken and beaten? When I was fighting? Why weren't you concerned about me then? But now that people are getting healed, now that my life is being changed, now that I've been set ablaze, now all of a sudden you're concerned about me. They're waiting for you to swell up. And that movement of that church is not going to make it. That new pastor, no ways. Well, watch what happens. But when they had waited a long time, not a time, a long time, when you're faithful, you're overcoming the flesh, the demonic comes against you, you shake it off and you continue. And for a long time you're faithful, doesn't matter what happens, you continue because God has spoken to you. You know, you're not called by people, you're called by Him. You know that you're called for a purpose. Doesn't matter what I see, doesn't matter what I'm going through, I'm going to go all the way through. And when they waited a long time, when there is fruit in your life, when you're starting to produce something because of faithfulness, they waited a long time and saw that he wasn't harmed. They changed their minds and decided that he was a God. In other words, they started to recognize the anointing on Paul. When he was faithful for a long time, they said, well, maybe this thing must be real. Maybe I must go to that church. I think I'm losing out. He didn't know God must be with that man. When he waited a long time, are you faithful in what God has given to you? Many people look at ministry, they think, oh, it's just, I'm going to say yes to Jesus and travel the whole world and have holiday and do all these things. There's a price to pay. Are you faithful with the headaches, but you want to see the wheelchairs? What's in your hand? Will you pray for someone in Spar, in Pick and Pay? There's a faithfulness to this. We're not in this for ourselves. It's about people. It's about His kingdom. Watch what happens when you overcome those things. Watch how favor starts to work in your life. Near the shore where we landed was an estate belonging to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us and treated us kindly for 3 days. Because he was faithful, the most wealthy man on that island invited them and said, come stay in my house. Because he recognized something. He recognized the anointing. When he partnered with that anointing and said, come into my house, watch what happened. As it happened, Publius' father was ill. Paul went in and prayed for him and laying hands on him, and he healed him. Hey. Then all, watch this. Then all the other sick people on the island came and they were healed. In other words, revival broke out on the island. Let's take it from the other side. Publius is on an island. The most wealthy man, his father is sick. The island is sick. Something's happening. I don't know what to do. Publius is praying, Lord, what must I do? My father is sick. If my people who are called by my name, if they would humble themselves, if they will turn from their wicked ways, I'll come and heal what? I'll heal the land. He's after not just an area, he's after the land. He's after the territory. He's after the territory. And he's praying, he said, Lord, send someone. Paul is on his way somewhere else. The Bible says those who are in step with the Spirit, those who are in tune with the Spirit, those are the mature sons of God. He's busy going somewhere else, and all of a sudden a wind comes. And he's in step. He's obedience. He's in the will of God. And someone's storm is turning into someone's answer. And he goes with it. All of a sudden, there's a storm. Okay, now we're going this way, but I'm in step with the Spirit. It feels like my life is falling apart. I'm in a storm here. My boat is being wrecked, but he ended up on the island. He's there by himself. He's alone. What must I do? He didn't feel sorry for himself for one second. He said, Lord, what must I do? And he was faithful. He overcame the flesh. He overcame what people thought about him. And then, watch what happens when you... I love his presence. Watch what happens when you are faithful. When you overcome the flesh. When you overcome the demonic. When you've done everything to stand and you keep standing. He never begged for anything. His ship is gone. What happens when you're faithful and God has called you? As a result, we were showered with honor. When you honor someone, you can receive from them. And when it was time to sail, people supplied us with everything we needed for the trip. God has called you. Everything that you need supplied for. When you overcome, when you're faithful, when there's fruit. The Bible says when you have fruit, you can ask Jesus anything. You can ask the Father anything through the name of Jesus, and He will give it to you. When there's fruit, when there's lasting fruit, hallelujah. You don't have to beg for anything. There's provision. Hallelujah. I'm excited. It's a privilege for me to be here this morning. Hallelujah. I want to go somewhere else quickly. Let's go here. I want to show you something I felt the Lord speak to me about the beginning of this year. I saw a pattern as a, maybe, let's say, as an evangelist. Remember, evangelists are those that barely make school. Those that their mom and dad pray them through. And as a young man, just reading the Bible, trying my best, Lord, being just in love with Jesus, I found myself in a difficult position. I think it's time to be honest and vulnerable from the pulpit. Is that okay? Because sometimes we preach from this place and we preach so down at the people, and people look at it and say, I'll never be good enough. We become a rock star and we think, hey, my goodness, people have to come bow before me. I want to show you what happened to me. I had such innocence and hunger for the Lord, and I can feel it's growing and growing and growing again. But I found myself last year coming from a stage. You can ask my wife. Every time when I preach and I walk off, I would cry for hours. I would cry and say, did you see that lady? She was healed. I would cry. I would say that you see that one soul came in, or that 100 souls came in, or that 5 souls came. I would cry. I would say that you see that man when he encountered Jesus, his facial expression changed. It's the best thing for me to see someone have their first encounter of Jesus. I love it. I love to see people have encounters. But something happened. And one day as I was preaching and I came from the platform, because the platform started to grow so fast in my life, when I came down from the pulpit, the first question I asked myself was that good enough? In that moment, I realized something is wrong with me. There's something, I've missed, something is wrong. Something's happening. I don't know what's wrong. I phoned my dad. I started to speak to him. I said, help me. I don't know what's going on. And I remember as I was preaching in Holland, I'm preaching one day from my heart. I'm preaching. And I hear this with an audible voice as I'm preaching. Werner, what do you love more? Preaching or my presence? When he asked me that question, I couldn't answer it. In the deepest of my deep, I wanted to say your presence, but I knew if I open up my mouth now, I'm going to lie before the King of Kings. He knows the answer. That's why he's asking the question. What do you love more? Preaching or my presence? My biggest fight as a preacher today is not to be more anointed. I'm anointed already. It's to stay innocent. It's to not lose my innocence. To stay humble before the King, doesn't matter what happens. And I started to pray. I said, Lord, help me. I locked myself back in my closet again. And He's so faithful. He was waiting there for me. And He showed me this in the book of Mark. I want to show you this. What happened to Jesus? I saw this pattern. Maybe I won't read it for the sake of time, but I'll tell you what happened there. The first thing happened, Jesus got baptized. He came to John. John said, I'm not even worthy. He baptized him. The Bible says he came out of the water. Heavens opened and the Holy Spirit came down in the form of a dove and settled on Jesus. In Luke, the Bible says Jesus received the Holy Spirit. Who was the first one that showed up when he got anointed, when he received the Holy Spirit? Why did I say when he anoints your head, your enemies becomes more? When he was anointed there, when he received the Holy Spirit, he was led into the wilderness. Who showed up? The enemy showed it up. The devil showed up. Now watch what happens. What happens when God anoints your life like that? Jesus walks, I'm not going to read it for sake of time. He walks past the fishermen. What must they have seen in Jesus? They're busy catching fish. If my wife back then, she would say, Werner, I was working. She said, you come home with something to eat. If there's nothing to eat, you're not coming home. They're busy catching fish. The wives are waiting. Jesus walks past them and says, follow me. They leave everything and they follow Him. When He anoints your life like that, He gives you influence. Influence in a way where you can change people's destinies. Therefore, there's a responsibility. When God anoints you, you can lead people wrong or right. There's a responsibility because you're anointed. Heaven paid a price for what's on your life. Therefore, character, so important. Now He gives you influence. Watch this. Just one thought. What must they have seen in Jesus when He said, go into the world and preach the gospel to all the earth. Heal the sick, raise the dead, clean. What must they have seen in Him? They saw a lifestyle. You know these people, let me go sidetrack quickly. Nowadays we hear this, don't become familiar with the man of God because then you can't receive from him. And they would preach this and say, when Jesus came to when he was in the garden and Judas betrayed him and the officers came to arrest Jesus, Now, normally they preach this and say they couldn't recognize Jesus because he was hanging out with the sinners. So they couldn't see him. I was flying one day and I heard the Holy Spirit say, that's not what's happening there. When they came to arrest Jesus, because he had a lifestyle with them, they saw how he lived. They moved with him. They operated with him. They became like him. Therefore, they didn't know which one is Jesus. He's making us a follower. Yet they were busy catching fish. Then he says, come, I'll make you a fisher of men. Then we look at Peter, someone that betrayed Jesus. Someone that was so radical that when Jesus came and said, who do men say I am? They said, some say you're Elijah. Some say you are Jeremiah. Some say you're one of the prophets. And Peter stood and said, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah. And then Jesus said, on this rock I'll build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's the same Peter that when Jesus got arrested, he took out his sword and he slashed someone's ear off. Now, I would have been like a Peter, but I'll take more than one ear. I'll take a couple of fingers also. It was a passionate man. He was a follower of Jesus. How can that same Peter, when he got arrested, say to a little girl, I don't know him. I was not one of them. For 3 times he denied Jesus. Huh? Then Jesus came. I'm just going off the sermon for 1 second. But in this house, we moved by the Spirit of God. Okay? Peter said, just go with the Spirit, please. How must we do this, Peter? You go with the Spirit. There's no A, B, and C here. It's the Spirit of God here. Now watch this. Jesus comes and he reveals himself after his death and resurrection. What did Peter do? Peter told the disciples and said, I'm going to go fishing. We read that in John, I think, 19 or 18. I'm going to go fishing. What was he saying? He was saying, I'm not going to be a fisher of men anymore. I'm going back to my old lifestyle. I'm going to go fishing. And he had such influence because he was with Jesus that all the others said, I'll follow you. Then Jesus came and he made a little fire of coals, the Bible said. Remember? Jesus restores him, says, go wait in the upper room. What happens? The Spirit of God comes upon him. The same Peter that denied Jesus, what happened? He was the one standing up and say, hey, they are not drunk as you suppose. He said, they're not drunk as you suppose. This was prophesied by the prophet Joel. In the last days, I'll pour my Spirit on all flesh. What happened then? As he was preaching, when we read in Acts chapter number 2, verse, I think, 30, around there. The Bible says, as he was speaking, they were cut to the heart. The people were cut to the heart. And then they said, how can we get this? How can we get what you have, Peter? The Peter that rejected Jesus, denied Jesus, that same one. How can we have? They were cut to the heart. If we preach the gospel without the Holy Spirit, if we preach the cross without the Holy Spirit, the cross will have no effect. But they were cut to the heart. That was the Spirit of God speaking. And he says, repent, turn to God. Be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you shall receive the Holy Spirit. The same Peter. And then he became so radical. Then he walked in Acts chapter number 3. Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have, stand up. The same Peter, Acts chapter number 4, he got in trouble, him and John, because they healed that man. Then he was arrested. Then he came before the council. And then they said, how is this possible? In Acts chapter number 4, how do you do this? By what name do you do this, Peter? And the Bible says, Peter stood up. This is my favorite part. He said to them, let it be known. He didn't say, let it be known by my professionalism. You see, last year I became professional and I started to miss God in my professionalism. Was that good enough? You're becoming professional, Werner. He said, let it be known by that name, the one you crucified, that name, that cornerstone, by that name, the Messiah, that name. This is what happened there. His heart's intention was made known right there. That same Peter, I can go further. That same Peter walked and his shadow healed people. Why? Because they were studying him. Why? Because now he did not just have an encounter. When he was walking and the sick was laid against on the sidewalks, he was on the way to the temple to pray. In other words, he not just had the encounter, he got a lifestyle. And they were looking at his lifestyle. Today, we need people not just coming and falling and then going back staying the same. We need people encountering Jesus and their lifestyle change. There's two things I believe that the church needs. That is a lifestyle change and that is the fear of God. Must I tell you what happens? I'm going off the script, but the fear of God. Ananias and Sapphira in the book of Acts chapter number 5. What happened? Peter stood before them. Peter said, why did you lie? The first man fall dead. Poof, the husband. Because Peter said, you've lied at the Holy Spirit. In other words, God put something upon Peter because of his lifestyle and the depth of his encounter that he now had a fear of God. When we say fear, it's a different fear than what we think. It's a fear of losing God. It's not like I'm fearful at a dog or my future. It's a different kind of fear. If you have that fear in your life, I'm scared of the future, it means you don't have the fear of God. That's a counterfeit fear. What happens when we fear God? I need to show you this. It's not part of my sermon, but I feel the anointing on this. What happens when we fear God? When it came out of Peter's mouth, why did you lie? Poof. Because he lived in such open heaven, such reality. He was so consumed by the fire of the Holy Ghost that when he opened his mouth, heaven, he was speaking on behalf of heaven. It was not his shadow healing the people. It was the open heaven. It was a realization who I am, what I carry, whose I am, in what kingdom I am. You see, there's a different walk to someone who's in the kingdom, to someone that has received the Holy Spirit. Your true identity comes forward when the Spirit of God comes upon you. My biggest fear was to speak in front of people, but when the Spirit of God comes, it flows. My English operates. But when I am not dependent and I become professional, then I'm in my own strength. Then I have to, oh, what's that word again? But when the Spirit of God comes, I get into the flow of the Holy Ghost. Then I'm in the river. Then I stand up in who I am. Then something happens. The anointing comes and it changes me into a different person because now my true identity comes forward. Hallelujah, Son of the Living God. We don't have to fight for a position. We have a position. It's time we wake up because the enemy can only produce orphans. I'm not orphan. I'm in a kingdom. Yay. On earth as it is in heaven. Hey, who's bringing heaven here? Lift up your head, O you gate. Be lifted up, you ancient door, because the King of Glory is about to come in through who? Through you. We have the privilege to release heaven on earth. We don't live from earth to heaven. We live from heaven to earth. I'm in this world, but not from this world. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives inside of me. Come on. Hey. What happens, verse? Acts chapter number 5. What happens when the fear of God comes back into a church? So great fear in verse number 11 came upon all the church and upon all those who heard these things. They heard what Peter did. They heard what was going on. The first thing that happens when the fear of God comes, verse number 12. And through the hands of the apostles, many signs, wonders, and miracles were done amongst the people. The first thing that happens when the fear of God comes back, it's not going to be a prayer line of 60% that gets healed. Everyone's going to get healed. Watch what happens. And signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord. When the fear of God comes back, in the church, number two, there will be unity. Why do you think there's such disunity amongst ministers, amongst churches? It's because the enemy is scared of one thing. What is that? It's the Great Commission. Because he knows that his time is running out. And when he can keep us busy with criticizing one another and not being in unity, we're not going to bring in the harvest. And then he's going to have a little bit time. Verse number 13. Every time I preach about something of the fear of God, it hits me. I feel it. In this house, I'm careful what I say. I have a respect for this house. I have a respect for what is in this place. I don't think you know what wells are available here. But it's time to redig those wells. We refuse to be lukewarm. We refuse not to be in revival. Yet none of the rest dare to join them. But the people esteemed them highly. Number 3, what does that mean? They esteemed them highly. When the church will fear God more, when the church will fear God more, the world will fear the church more. They will esteem us highly and say, church, what do you have to say? Good word, skinny man. And the believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes, both men and women. What will happen? We don't have to have a 5-step plan to build a bigger church. How to get more church members? He will add them. He will bring them. So that they brought the sick out into the streets and lay them in beds and couches, and the least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. In other words, the signs and wonders will not just break out in the church, it will go out of the church. It will go with you everywhere you go, because now you have a lifestyle. Also, a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities in Jerusalem, bringing the sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all healed. Going back to Jesus that got baptized by John, walks past the 4 fishermen, they started to follow him. Watch this. Jesus begins his ministry in Galilee. Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. What did he preach? He didn't preach funny things. He preached the kingdom. And saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. What did he preach? I was reading some of those things. I think John the Baptist was not just saying, Jesus loves you. You're going to make it. You're going to be okay. He was saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Make a choice. I'm not threatening you when I speak that way, because you threaten your enemy, but you warn your loved one. Because I love you, I'm not going to preach, he loves you, you're going to make it just hyper grace all the way. When you fear God, you're not going to make grace cheap. No, they say this, nothing's going to snatch you from the hand of God. Excuse me, you can take yourself out of the hand of God. Sorry if I'm stepping on someone's toes there. 4 fishermen started to follow him. You need to see this. I'm skipping down. Jesus, watch this. 21. Watch this. Please listen carefully. Then they went into Capernaum. And immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. After he got baptized, all of a sudden there's a difference on him. We're recognizing something. There's a different authority. They were going on, I think it was on Fridays. Every Friday in that temple or whatever it is, the scribes would teach. This specific time after he received the Holy Spirit, they recognized something different here. Watch the pattern, please. I need to show you this. This is a now word. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught as someone having an authority and not as the scribes. Now, please, here it comes. Now, there was a man in the synagogue with an unclean spirit. And he cried out. Who cried out? The Spirit. The Spirit said what? Let us alone. Follow me. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth, that you come to destroy us? Never once did he communicate to them. Never once did he say anything to them. He was preaching the kingdom of God with authority. They reacted and they started to speak to him, asking questions. Watch this. And they recognized, you are the Messiah. They were more clever than the people there. Because the people there didn't even recognize he's the Messiah. But the demons recognized, what have you to do with us? Now watch here. You come to destroy us. I know you are the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebuked them, saying what? Be quiet and come out of him. Jesus didn't go, I'm sorry, I don't know what you believe, but I'm reading my word. Jesus didn't go, how long have you been here? Tell me more. Just get another camera angle there. I've come to destroy you. Just get that angle. Sorry, say again, why did you come here? Reading the word of God, I know this is a sensitive topic, but when I read the word of God, what did he say? Be quiet. Watch this. Follow the pattern. It's not finished. Follow this. He said, be quiet and come out. And when the unclean spirit had convulsed and cried out with a loud voice, he came out of him. Then they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, what is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority he commanded even the unclean spirits, and they obeyed him. And immediately, watch this, immediately his fame spread through all the region of Galilee. His fame did not spread because he posted on Instagram. His fame did not spread because he made a video of casting out a demon, having a conversation, and now it spread and boosting it and putting money behind that. His fame didn't spread because he put up posters about him. His fame spread because he preached the kingdom. His fame spread because there was an authority. His fame spread. I know nowadays there's conversations and these things happening. What I'm saying is we don't have to speak to demons. But what I'm also saying, when I look at the pattern, when you speak with a demon or whatever, it's not for the sake of entertainment. It's for interrogation purposes. And last time I checked, he said, be quiet. He didn't allow it. Now follow me, because we're not finished with what the word is saying, not my opinion. It's not my opinion. Now, as soon as they had heard, oh, the Spirit of God, watch this, verse number 29. As soon as they had come out of the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. But Simon's wife, his mother, was sick with a fever, and they told him about her at once. So he came to them and he healed her. Now remember, he came to the one after he got anointed. What happens when you're faithful with the one? When God gives you something and you're faithful with the one, what happens? Just after that, at evening, when the sun had set, he brought to them all who were sick and those who were demon-possessed, and the whole city, because he was faithful with the one, the whole city was gathered together at the door. Then he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he did not allow the demons to speak. He did not allow the demons to speak because they knew who he was. If you know who you are, if you know what you carry, he did not allow them to speak because he knew. They knew who he was. It goes on. He showed me a whole pattern here for my ministry and how to do ministry, or how to do life and to stay humble. I had to ask myself, why do I post? Why do I do things? What am I preaching? There's a responsibility. You need to keep that fire going. Amen. Can I read one more scripture? Then my intro has been released. Are you still okay? God is good. He's so good. I want to read to you this. What is the intention? What is the motive? What's the motive of your heart? That we have to ask ourselves this in anything we do. And I read this and it just really jumped open. It just opened to me in Ephesians chapter number 3, verse 14. This is Paul and he's praying. He said, "For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth are named." You have a name. You're part of the family. Paul is praying. He says that he would grant to you. He's praying that God would give you something. It's so important that he goes to his knees praying for me and you. He says, according to the riches of his glory. So what is he praying for? So that we, the Bible says, to be strengthened with might through the Holy Spirit in the inner man. The Bible says in the Amplified, it says to be reinforced with mighty power in the inner man. Watch this. That Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. That you being what? Rooted and grounded in love. He's praying, Father, you have to give them this. What? They need to be strengthened. Why? So that they can stay rooted and grounded. Why? So that they may comprehend with all the saints what is the width, the length, the depth, and the height. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask, think, or imagine. If you are not rooted and grounded in the love of Jesus, you're not going to see the exceedingly abundantly far above. What happens when God starts using us, if we lose focus and we're not rooted and grounded in love, we're not going to see the greater things that he has for us, because he loves us so much that he does not want to destroy us. This must be our heart's attention. This must be the motivation of what we do and why we do it. This is the kingdom, is that we root it and ground it so that he fills us with his love, so that we have love to give. Now let me end on a lighter note for you. God is good. Is it okay if I tell a story? I always get in trouble for my stories. But let me tell you a story to end it off with an altar call. Is that okay? Are you okay, Pastor Petrus? Now let me tell this story. Me and my wife one day, I always looked and said to my wife, now if I had this encounter, why does it look like the church is more depressed than the world? Not this church. But why does it look like some of the church is more depressed than the world? The Bible says the kingdom of God's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The Bible says in John 14, it says that he will give you peace of mind. When he gives you the Holy Spirit, the gift, you will have peace of mind and peace of heart. Then it says, don't be troubled and afraid. Many people are troubled and afraid because they don't have the peace of mind, the peace of heart that's been given by the Holy Spirit. That's why it looks nowadays that people have lost their minds. They are troubled and afraid because they've not received the gift. Hallelujah. Now, on the way to a wedding, me and my wife, we're driving. This is years ago. And I told my wife, I said, tonight I'm going to get drunk. And my wife knows I don't drink. I made a choice. So I said, I'm going to get drunk tonight. So like any other wife, they just wait. What's this man going to say? I said, I'm going to get smashed tonight. I'm going to get under the influence tonight. So my wife looks at me. She's waiting. I said, why does it look like a church is more depressed than the world? Something is off. I said, tonight at this wedding, I'm going to get drunk. Now she's waiting. I said, I'm going to get filled with the Holy Ghost. Now we're on the way to the wedding. Now, I don't know how it works here in Klerksdorp and Stilfontein, but in Kimberley, where I grew up, our weddings, the way it works, we have a nice time, but the moment the DJ comes and he turns on the music, there's only one beat. It's poof, 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 poof. That's all. All the songs, one beat. Let's go. The moment the music is turned on, it's the tables are being moved. So no long arm. Huh? Does it work here? We're moving the tables. But then you get 90% of men. They go to this one corner. And the music starts. Then they stand here at something called the pub. The barman is busy giving drinks because 90% of men, they've not received the gift of moving when music is playing. I'm one of those. It doesn't work automatically. It doesn't come spontaneously. So I'm one of the standing in the corner ones. But 10% of the men, they just go. It just works for them. They just flow. And all the ladies, they go to the dance floor and they wait for their husbands. Come. All the husbands say, no, next song, next song. They stand there the whole night. Next song, next song. Eventually they forget their wives are there. No, the beat's not right. Next one. Now I'm one of the 90%ers. So the music starts, I come to the corner, I'm sitting here. And I remember, but didn't I say I'm going to get smashed? Didn't I say I'm going to get under the influence? My wife's on the dance floor, she's looking at me. I said, Lord, you, this is difficult. So eventually I start walking, I say, okay, let's go for it. Feels like everyone is watching me. Oh my goodness. My wife's waiting there. The music is playing, I'm dancing, and my wife looks at me. Why aren't you dancing? I said, I'm dancing. I'm dancing inside, but outside nothing's happening. I'm stuck there. She says, dance. I said, Lord, yeah, you have to help me here. Nothing is working. So I said, Lord, fill me, Holy Ghost. And all of a sudden, I felt there's movement in the lower section. Something is happening. I said, Holy Ghost, you got to fill me up. And eventually I said, but things are happening. Now, I don't know if you have ever gone to a pub or a kroeg or a tavern. You don't know, but let me tell you, because you've never been there. On a Friday, the man has worked here in Stilfontein. The whole week he has worked and he comes back and now he receives his pay. He comes from the main. Huh? Now he comes there on a Friday, gets his pay and he walks into the pub. His shoulders are hanging, no personality. He sits there, nothing's coming out of his mouth and he shows the barman. Barman knows what to do. The man just drinks his drink. Finish with that one, he goes again. Barman knows. The third one, this man gets a voice. Hello. He takes another one. Now there's a personality coming out. Have you seen that? He takes another one. You see, now he stands up. He makes friends. Hey, how are you doing? Hey, man, hey. Something is coming alive in him. He goes back. He says, hey, that little ones. My friends, give them those little ones. Later on, he's dancing there in the middle. He becomes louder. The same way I'm standing on that dance floor. Holy Spirit, fill me. All of a sudden, he's filling me. Wait, I feel a confidence. I feel the fear of man falling off. Don't get drunk on wine, but get filled with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is filling me. Now there's a confidence. Now I'm moving. What's happening here? Yay! The difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. The next day, they wake up. Eish. Mommy is shouting, we need Omo. Wake up. Go to the shop. Man's head is spinning. Oh, ish. Money. Wallet is empty. Kingdom of light. I wake up. Wallet is stacked. I'm a tither. I'm a sower. There's no headache. I'm just more in love with Jesus. Don't get drunk on wine. Get filled with the Holy Ghost. Keep drinking and keep leaking. Hallelujah. I want to pray with you this morning. I'm going to end here. Yes, I almost wanted to do another story, but let's leave that one. I don't know if Stilfontein's ready for that one. Hey. Why are you sitting so far? Normally the backsliders, they sit there at the back. Huh? God is good, man. We are in a good season. We're going to show the world what joy looks like. The world is groaning. They're shouting out. They're waiting for us to manifest, for us to wake up. You know what? The enemy knows who you are. God knows who you are. The creation knows who you are because the creation is groaning. Don't you think it's time that we wake up and realize who we are? See, if we know who we are, we're going to walk differently. We're going to talk differently. We're going to move differently. Hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. A hunger inside of you. I've got such a hunger burning in me. When I look at Smith Wigglesworth, those men of God, one day a man, his friend, came to the front door. He knocked on his door. Smith Wigglesworth started to come to the door, opened the door. He asked his friend, "What is that under your arm?" He says, "It's a newspaper." He said, "You're not coming into my house with that." That's how radical that man was. I read the story. That man had such an intense hunger. He had such a prayer life that his friends would come, ministers would come and pray with him in a room. When they prayed in a room, then one by one they had to leave out of that place because of the glory of God starting to come into that place. And then he would find himself in that room alone, by himself. There was this man, Charles Finney. When I read that, he was walking on the sidewalk laughing under the Spirit of God. People would say, "You're crazy." There's the laughing man. There's the man that's always laughing. Something must be wrong in his head. He must be crazy. He had such a hunger inside of him. God birthed one of the biggest revivals through his life. Then there was a man, Smith. No, what's that man? William Seymour, 1904. He had such a hunger, he was not even allowed in the church. A black man with one eye, you're not allowed in church. He would sit at the door of the church listening because he wanted to be baptized, speaking in heavenly languages. And then that man got filled by the Holy Ghost. The Bible said that when he started to preach, not the Bible, the history books, he would take a box and put it on his head. He had such a relationship with God that they said, it's recorded that he would wait hours with a box on his head and he would not move until God says move. That's a different kind of fear of man. He didn't care about a reputation. He didn't care about what are people going to think. God said, put the box on my head. I'm going to keep this box on my head. Come on. Even in this house, we know what have happened here. There was a hunger. There was a desperation. There was a diligence. There was something that created this. Someone had to go that deep. I'm telling you, it's not good enough to go to someone's fire because you don't have a fire. It's time you carry your own fire. It's time we put wood on that fire and we let that fire grow. Otherwise, we'll always be dependent on one man of God here and one man of God there. It's time that the saints stand up in the things of God. Yeah, and if I speak this way, I'm not angry, I'm passionate. A saints movement. The fivefold is here. For what reason? It's not about the man of God. God chooses men and women. Men and women of God. To activate the call that is in the saints so that the saints can wake up, that the saints can walk in the mighty signs, the wonders, the miracles. Hallelujah. I'm just stirring a hunger in you because I've been in church. I grew up in church. I've seen many things in church. All of us, we've seen many things in church, but I'm telling you, I know that we are living in the greatest hour if we are willing to stand up, if we're willing to take what He has for us. As a family, if we're going to say, we're taking the city, I'm taking my street, I'm taking my household, I'm taking my own bedroom by starting to make up my bed, I'm going to live differently, that by my lifestyle, they will encounter Him. By looking at my lifestyle, the way I'm living, the world has to say there's something different. If you look in my eyes, you have to see something. What does it help? You get introduced to Werner Strydom, but you walk out of this place with Werner. You have to walk out with Jesus. You have to be introduced to Him. There's more available, saints. There's so much more available. I'm just stirring your hunger. We're going to sing a song now. I want you to respond. We're going to raise our hands. You can stand. You can sit. Let's sing for a moment. Then we'll see you make an altar call. We're going to lay hands on people this morning. But I want you to know there's a lifestyle. May we carry the fear of God. I remember in my life this one encounter that marked me forever. I was in a little church by myself as a young man. I said, Lord, I want to see your heart. I want to see your heart. And I remember for more than an hour I went, I want to see your heart. I started to become so desperate with my new guitar. I said, I need to see your heart. Show me your heart. And I remember it was like the door opened and the weight of God started to come into that place. It's like He's walking closer and closer and closer. I fell to the ground. In that moment, the light was so bright that my own hands had to hide my eyes. I felt like the smallest thing on this whole earth. For hours I was stuck on the floor, crying, hiding my eyes. You can ask my wife, I burst all of the veins in both of my eyes. That was the intensity of that encounter I had. Lying on the floor for hours. Eventually I felt it went like this. With every fiber of my being, I call out, come closer. But I knew if He came closer, I would explode. And as I was driving back, I didn't know what happened. I'm praying. I said, Lord, what's wrong? What am I feeling? I heard His voice. He said, I've showed you how I cry over the lost. He said, and if I had to show you more, your body wouldn't be able to handle it and you would have died. May God give you an encounter this morning. May He turn your life upside down this morning, that you'll walk different, talk different. There's many people, they have encounters, but they use the same cuss words. They encounter God, but nothing changes. They encounter God, but no behaviors change. There's some things that needs to change. When we encounter Him, we cannot just have the encounter and walk away. We need to connect to the source. Hallelujah. Whew. I want you to raise your hands this morning. I stand in awe. I stand in awe. I stand in awe. All glory, all honor, all worship and all praise, all blessing, all power, how worthy is your name. All glory, all honor, all worship and all praise,
blessing, all honor. How worthy is your name. I stand in awe. I stand in awe. I stand in awe of you. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon thy cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon thy cross. For here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. I'm going to make an invitation. I want you to stay in this atmosphere. If you're here this morning, I want to pray for you. We spoke about the fire of God. I want to pray that the fire of God touch you. And I'm going to pray with you. And as you stand up, that fire that's in you, that it will increase. That it will not just be a one moment thing or a one morning service thing. But God will set you ablaze so that you can walk in the things that He's called for you. When He anoints you, when He calls you, when He touches you in times like these, and His fire comes upon your life, it attracts everything you need for the race. But we need to know that the wood have to be put on the fire. We have to live a holy life. We have to make choices. We have to stand. And this morning I want to pray. I hope most of you come. But I'm just going to go past you, and I'm going to trust God that this fire will set you ablaze. Some of you burning already, then you'll know there's always more fire. There's always more fire. I always run to almost every altar call, just in case I get something new. And every time He's faithful, because He looks at your hunger. If you come just for the sake of coming, please don't come. I want you to sit down. Then it was a great service. We love you. We see you next time. But I want you to come as someone that has hunger, someone that has a desperation, someone that says enough is enough, I need more. Someone that says, if you don't take it, I'll take it. Someone that says, God's not touching me, I'm going to touch Him. Someone that came like that lady with the issue of blood. When she touched Him, He said, something happened, something left. Are you making a demand on His presence this morning? Are you making a demand to take what is available for you? Are you making a demand to say, I'm not leaving empty-handed here. I'm not leaving ice cold here. Because there's many people speaking about the fire, but there's no fire. Enough is enough. We have to walk in the fire. When you're on fire, you don't have to say you're on fire. People can feel the heat when you close. People can see in your eyes you're on fire. People can see in your eyes that you love Jesus. When I look at this man, every time I see him, I can see he loves Jesus. He doesn't have to say, I love Jesus. You can see it. He does the welcoming. You can see he loves Jesus. He speaks the first word and the atmosphere changes, because he has the lifestyle. He has a lifestyle. It's a daily thing.
He carries it. He cannot help himself to cry. I got in a place as a minister where the minister started to make fun and say, oh, Werner is crying again. I said, I'm not crying for any human being on this earth. I'm praying because the King of Kings have changed me. I was not supposed to be here. I was supposed to be dead. I was supposed to be in prison. But He touched me and He gave me a new soft heart. I had a hard heart. I don't have to operate in a gift. I operate in love. I operate because I'm in love. When I say I'm in love, when I open my mouth and sing, I know the atmosphere change. I know when I sing, the glory of God comes. It's not arrogance. It's because I do it at home. It's because I live in it. I walk in it. I operate in it. It's my best friend. And I'm only saying this. When I pray for you, I'm not alone. I've not come here alone. I'm not coming as Werner. I'm not coming alone. You're not moving alone. Come on. We need to realize our job is not finished. He's created you in His workmanship. What is workmanship? It's when something is made. Something or someone is made by someone for a specific purpose to get the job done. You made in His as His workmanship to get the job done. You still have a job. That's why you're here. This morning when you woke up and you went like this, there's still a breath in my lung. My mouth is still working. My hands are still working. In other words, my job is not done. In other words, I still have something to do on this earth. He needs you here. He doesn't need you there. He needs you now. Hallelujah. So if you're in this place, you say, that's me. I make a choice. Hey, I want you to come out. If you have to run out, you run out. If you crawl out, you crawl out. Whatever you have to do this morning. Are we just going to go past? I believe as my hand touch you, His hand will come through my hand. And you will be fired up this morning. Am I going to anoint people? So there's this anointing oil. Okay. You will walk with me. Okay. Hallelujah. Don't just come to come, please. We speak into the atmosphere. This is just the beginning. You've ain't seen nothing yet. God's not finished with this church. You've ain't seen nothing yet. Get ready. Get ready. La bravande cos cataya. Le breverda cos catande. I honor you for your faithfulness. There's many of you I can feel that you are hungry. I can feel you pulling it. There's some of you, you need to get hunger. If you're not hungry, say, Lord, help me to be hungry. Help me, Spirit of God, to be hungry for you. He says, those who are thirsty, come and drink. Are you thirsty to come and drink? Because when you drink, rivers of living waters will flow from your innermost being. When you drink, those rivers is not just for you. When those rivers flow, it is for the world to come and drink. Hallelujah. Sekravarde bosta. I want you to raise your hands, close your eyes. Don't wait for anyone. Don't wait for a person. He can do it now. He can touch you now. We're going to go fast. I'm just going to lay my hand on you quickly. But I want you, come on, get a hunger. Get a hunger. Get a hunger. Get a desperation. Come on. There's some of you, he's raising up businessmen. He's raising up you in your sphere of influence. As Jesus, when He said to those fishermen, come, He had an influence. God is going to increase your influence because of your faithfulness. What do you do with what He has given you? Hallelujah. Shabravande Breskitaya. I'm just waiting. Why am I still speaking? I wait till He says pray. I don't just pray. And I don't just start one side and end another way. I go where He says go. I'll start where He says I must start. Come on, call out. Call out. Hey, His presence. He's going to shift some of you. This man here. I'm going to start with this man. It's happening already. Hey. Shabraskataya. Shabraskataya. fire of the Holy Ghost. Touch. Fire. Release. Fire. There he goes. Release. That's it. That's it. That's it. Release. Release. Holy, holy. Holy cry. There he goes.